Phenomenal consciousness is one of the hardest problems within modern philosophy. All the theories that we've been discussing during the past months have not succeeded in giving an adequate explanation of it. But there are three different solutions to this issue, but they are all radical and filled with problems. But why is phenomenal consciousness so hard to explain? And what are these solutions? Those are the questions that I aim to answer within this video. In my last video, I discussed four different kinds of consciousnesses, but now we're only concerned with the last one, which is phenomenal consciousness. Before we can tackle the first question, we need to understand a key feature within modern philosophy. And that is the reductionist agenda regarding ontology. What is ontology, you might ask? Well, ontos is Greek for being or that which is. So ontology is the study of being or what actually exists. One of the main virtues within ontology is economy. Meaning, we want to be able to explain as much as possible with the least amount of ontological categories. Anything we don't need, we should cut away using Occam's razor. This is the reductionist agenda. Let me give you an example. Take chairs, for instance. Plato would probably have argued that there is a perfect form of chairs. A form in which all chairs in our world take part in. So Plato not only postulated the universal of chairs, but he also thought that there was a separate world in which every universal resides. The world of forms. But this is unnecessary, really, because chairs don't exist. Oh, well. Obviously, chairs exist in a way, but not the way Plato thought. Every chair in the world consists of atoms. So we don't need the universal of chairs. We only need the Aristotelian universals of atoms, for instance. Unless you're a sneaky trope theorist. In this case, we have explained the existence of chairs through its smaller constituents. We have performed a reduction. Now, the aim of modern philosophy has been to basically reduce everything in the world to atoms or mechanistic qualities or even sometimes functions. But the thing with phenomenal consciousness is that it resists this reduction. No one seems to have given an accurate scientific reduction or explanation of phenomenal consciousness. But maybe that's impossible. Now, let me just recap what I said about phenomenal consciousness in the last episode. If two people are sitting on a beach enjoying a beautiful sunset, both of them are possessing a certain qualitative feel, a property of what it is likeness. If they both are normally functioning people, their what it is likeness is, in theory at least, identical. But let's say that the person to the right is completely colorblind. Then these two people have fundamentally different qualitative experiences, or qualia. They are both looking at the same scene, but their experiences are quite different. But why is this such a big problem? Well, let's turn it up a notch. Let's say that instead of the second person being colorblind, he perceives the redness of the sunset as though it was green. So whenever he points at something exclaiming red, he perceives it as green. The thing is that even though these two people have two very different qualitative experiences when they look at the same sunset. They are both 100% functioning. There is no problem for them to function within the world. This is sometimes referred to as the inverted spectrum thought experiment, and it seems to prove that qualia doesn't really have any function at all. Let's spice it up even more. We could imagine a possible world in which I live my life exactly the way I do within this world, except for that I experience purple as though it was red. The crux here is that, physically speaking, these two worlds are exactly identical in every way, but experience-wise, they are quite different. Therefore, qualia cannot be something physical. So the problem with qualia is that we cannot really analyze its existence through its causal role, because it's logically compatible with its absence. For instance, we can imagine a robot that functionally does everything that a human does. It even simulates pain when something happens to it. But even though it's functioning as a human, we have no reason to believe that this robot actually feels anything at all. It's not phenomenally conscious. Here, the philosopher Thomas Nagel defines consciousness. But fundamentally, an organism has conscious mental states if and only if there is something that it is like to be that organism. Something it is like for the organism. So, in the robot example, there is nothing that it is like to be that robot, since it lacks qualia. So if qualia cannot be analyzed through its causal role, can we ever create a science of consciousness? Probably not. To elaborate, let's talk about bats. Just like there is something that it is like to be a human, there is something that it is like to be a bat. But can I, a human, ever possess a bat's what it is likeness? Probably not. For instance, I could imagine myself closing my eyes, hanging upside down, and screaming as loud as I can to try to sense my surroundings. If so, would I possess a bat's what it is likeness? No. Here Nagel writes, "It tells me only what it would be like for me to behave as a bat behaves." But that is not the question. I want to know what it is like for a bat to be a bat. Yet, if I try to imagine this, I am restricted to the resources of my own mind, and those resources are inadequate to the task. When we conduct science, we endeavor to be as objective as possible. In other words, we're trying to strip away all the particular viewpoints, remove our specific individual points of view to an objective one. Within science, we're moving from the sensory appearance of things to actual reality. We're aiming to move from subjectivity to objectivity. But here is the kicker. The scientific move from sensory appearance to greater objectivity doesn't make any sense upon this matter. Because what we're after is itself the appearance. We're asking for an objective account of the subjective account. So this seems to be an impossible task for science. It's by definition a contradictory endeavor. Science is in nature objective, but what we're asking for is the question of subjective experience. This leaves us with what Joseph Levine refers to as an explanatory gap. Take these two statements. 1. Pain is the firing of C-fibers. 2. Heat is the motion of molecules. Both of these two propositions have a felt contingency. In other words, heat and pain could have been identified with something else. But the second statement can easily be explained away, but not the first one. Levine writes, "The difference between the two cases is this. When it seems plausible that two is contingent, one can become disabused of this notion by noting that instead of imagining heat without the motion of molecules, one is really imagining there being some phenomenon that affects our senses the way heat in fact does, but is not the motion of molecules. But the sensation of pain counts as pain itself. We cannot make the distinction here, as we can with heat, between the way it appears to us and the phenomenon itself. Thus, we have no good account of our intuition that one is contingent, unless we give up the truth of one altogether. We can indeed imagine someone experiencing pain without any C-fibers firing at all. Take, for instance, the case of phantom pain. If someone has lost a leg due to some accident, she might sometimes experience intense pain within the lost leg. But how can that be? No C-fibers are possibly firing within the non-existent leg. Hopefully you understand why this is such a big problem. But now, let's look at these three different solutions that I talked about in the beginning. Firstly, we have the eliminativist position. The philosopher Daniel Dennett is a proponent of this view. He endeavors to explain consciousness away, showing that qualia don't really exist at all. It's a mere illusion. I myself am not so fond of this view. I think it clashes with our common sense. And also, it's just odd to say that whatever you are experiencing is an illusion, which one can simply reply with, "Oh, so if what I am experiencing is an illusion, then what is real? If everything that I experience is an illusion, then there is no difference between illusions and non-illusions, upon which consciousness reappears, it seems." Secondly, we have the panpsychist view, which is probably the most bold view there is. This view claims that everything in the world possesses some small degree of consciousness. Even photons and subatomic particles experience things. And the more information or whatnot that gets concentrated within one area, the phenomenal experience compounds. So a human brain possesses a large quantity of information, therefore we have a lot of consciousness. I believe that the Dutch philosopher Baruch Spinoza held such a view. I reject this view for basically the same reason I reject Dennett's proposition. It clashes way too much with our common sense. We do not look at stones as though they are conscious. Claiming that they are is just way too much metaphysical hokey-pokey for me, at least. A plausible revision of the panpsychist view could maybe be by claiming that only biological entities possess degrees of consciousness. And that sounds pretty plausible. But lastly, we have what I would call the ontological view. This is to, in a way, acknowledge that phenomenal consciousness cannot be fully reduced to something mechanistic. It is its own ontological category. Levine writes, "For instance, I presume that the laws of gravity explain, in the sense at issue here, the phenomena of falling bodies. There doesn't seem to be anything left out. Yet I am told that the value of G, the gravitational constant, is not derived from any basic laws. It is given, a primitive, brute fact about the universe. So, phenomenal conscious could be the same, a brute fact of the universe. This does not necessarily entail immortality or anything like that. It just claims that the property of what it is likeness cannot be fully reduced to physical phenomena. But if it's not reducible to functions, does it have any causal power at all? Maybe, maybe not. But that will be the discussion of a future episode where I will be talking about epiphenomenalism. But if you want to know more about other kinds of consciousness, then I suggest you check out this video here.